right, well, pray for me as I speak to you tonight. I hope everything that's up here and in here can come out of here the way it was received. So thank you, Brother Markey. In case it doesn't, here's a little bit of an outline of what we're going to be talking about over the next 4 to 6 weeks. Probably four, but I'll try to squeeze it in. If you just pass those back. And I also want to just announce real quick before I forget that our CERT class is scheduled. It's on the, on the internet, our Facebook page as well as our website. Yes, thank you. Okay. It will be in May, and there's some flyers up here that I'll hand out. But all the information, it's going to be a good class, so I hope you can all come and attend. So we're going to be talking about leadership. And again, I desire your prayers. It's divided into six sections, say that slowly. And I've given you the handout for that. But tonight, we're going to talk about the draft. And what this is we're going to know and understand what you're signing up for. You want to lead something, what are we leading, right? And all of the scripture references are on there. Over the next several weeks, we're also going to be talking about actually accepting that call once you fully understand what it is. Clear communications, basic training, knowledge of weapons, and rising to the occasion. Kind of sounds like we're in a war, right? It does, doesn't it? Okay, yes, we are. We are. I'm glad you feel that way. I'm going to be drawing from God's Word, our reading material, and the scriptures referenced there on your handout, but also from Developing the Leader Within You, which is John C. Maxwell. If you want to read the book, I won't be teaching straight out of it, but I will be referring to him a lot. And also Leadership Behind the Scenes, Dr. Ron Webb. So those are, I'm going to be referring to references in that book a lot. So those books. I need just a second. I'm just going to pray, okay? I need y'all to bow your head and pray with me. Father in heaven, God, I love you. And I just submit myself to you tonight, Father. I submit myself and everything that I am, Lord. I want to come to the end of me, God, that your word would come forth through me, Father. Father, I praise you and I thank you, Lord, as you open the hearts, Father, as we open our hearts to you, God, to receive from you, Father, I ask, God, that you would consume, God. Lord, that you would reveal yourself in a mighty way, Father, and that you would lead and guide your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. So, leadership. Who does it apply to? Everybody. It does, doesn't it? It does. John C. Maxwell's definition of leadership is simply put, the ability to obtain followers. Anyone in this room can and probably has at some point in your life obtained a follower. How many of you are on Facebook? You've attained a few followers. Please be careful in the way that you lead them. So we all have influence on someone, whether it's our children, our family, a loved one, a friend, a coworker, whatever it is. And some of our realms of influence are large. Some of them are in a close-knit circle, but we have influence on people. So the ability to obtain followers, that's what leadership is all about. The Great Commission is all about obtaining followers, right? Matthew 28:18 reads, "And Jesus came to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Amen." So if you want to follow Jesus, you become a disciple and you make disciples. So I'm following Jesus and I'm obtaining followers. So by definition and by order of the Great Commission, like Amanda said, everyone's a leader. You're a leader. I'm a leader. Well, all right. That was a good class. That went rather well. I didn't mess anything up. So wouldn't it be great, though, if it were that simple? We could just get that out of the way and move on to fame, fortune, prosperity, and ministry. Is that how it works, Brother Todd? Is that how it works? Is that what I hear? It doesn't, though, does it? I bet if we were to ask you and Sister Melissa, it cost you something, didn't it? I bet if we were to ask Sister Amanda, it cost you something, didn't it? It's cost you. It continues to cost you, doesn't it, Brother Chuck? You know, it cost you your time. It cost you your heart. It cost you something. So we'll start with what leadership is not in the kingdom. It is not necessarily power and prestige. It is not fame, fortune, and prosperity. Having your name on a sign, or preaching, teaching, singing, all the blessings and accolades and recognition that goes with that. However, leaders may have and do any and all of those things, but none of these things is what makes them a leader, is it? So what is leadership in the kingdom? In the kingdom? Anybody? Any thoughts? There's no wrong answer. Servant of all. Yeah. Following him. Oh, I'm anxious to see what looks I get when I give you this answer. And all of those answers are correct. Leadership in the kingdom is war. It's war. I'm going to try to tie that together for you tonight. But it is war. It's a fight. You need to know that. You need to know what you signed up for. Let's talk logistics for just a minute. Kingdom logistics. When you became a disciple of Jesus Christ, you became a part of a kingdom that is not of this world, right? But you will live and occupy, which is a militant term, by the way, you will live and you will occupy this world, in which the ruler of is who? Satan. So, and Satan is in every way opposed to you and your king. Am I right? In every way. And the Lord, God is so good. Tonight, when Sister Tammy led us in the Lord's Prayer tonight, when you pray that prayer, I want you to think about what you're praying. When you pray, Lord, your kingdom come, Lord, your will be done right here on earth as it is in heaven. What you are actually saying to God is for him to use you to invade the kingdom that you are now occupying. That is militant in every sense of the word. It is a militant church. It is a militant call. And see, I fear that sometimes we have enlisted people through false pretenses. We have enlisted them because we've placed more emphasis sometimes on the blessings of God and on the harvest than what we do on service or active duty. It is active duty. It is active duty. Active until you draw your last breath. It is active duty. We ourselves have sometimes, myself included, have treated the church like a social club with events and programs. Not that these things are bad, but what's after them? There's more. There's more, Brother Chuck. Most American churches grow up, our young people, so accustomed to entertainment, and then we wonder why they can't sit in an adult service. We teach our babies to color, and we teach them to make cute little crafts instead of weaving the Word of God into their hearts and into their minds, preparing them from the battle that they will surely face when they are older, instead of teaching them to pray, and much less pray effectively and fervently, Aunt Linda. And why do you think that we have young men and women, as well as grown men and women, who are uncomfortable praying in a group or even at home? How did we get there? How did we get there? If his house is a house of prayer, how did we get there? We don't recognize the power or the value of prayer. They see it as something we merely do at mealtimes or in a church service. We place more emphasis on prayer requests than we actually place on prayer. The men and women of this local body are about to embark on a study, the War Room study. And I implore you, every single one of you, to go to this, to attend it, but not to just attend it, but to take an active part in this. But you need to understand, it's not a virtual Bible study. It's not a virtual reality Bible study, is it, Sister Amanda? It's a it's real. You can attend, you can go and you can attend and you can discuss, and then you can just disengage when you go home. Just like some sort of virtual reality game. A lot of times we put the goggles on and we're in another world for just a minute, and we do what we're supposed to do, and we, you know, we react to everything that's coming at us, but then we take the goggles off and we disengage and we go on about our daily lives. Just like it was that easy. We just put the goggles down. You disengage. If you're on active duty, is there ever a time that you get to disengage? If you're a watchman on call, is there ever a time that you get to disengage unless you have relief come? No, there's not. We sing that song all the time, Hold the Fort. I love that song. I love that old song. Hold the fort. That's what we're to do. We're to occupy until he comes. We're to hold the fort, defend it with all that we have, and fight for it. So I implore you to go to this study. I implore you to, I beg you to actively participate in it. Apply these principles in your home daily with your family. It should not just become another social event where we discuss prayer. We are not, understand this, we are not in a virtual war. We are fighting a very real enemy, Brother Todd. We are fighting a very real enemy in a very real war with real casualties. How many of you see some casualties? How many of you have had casualties in your life? In the body of Christ, I'm not talking about out in the world. There's all kinds of chaos and stuff, but I'm talking about the casualties that we've suffered right here in the body of Christ. Some of our marriages in this body are casualties of war, aren't they? Some of our children are casualties of this war. Some of our loved ones, our other loved ones, our brothers, sisters, wives, husbands are casualties of this war. Our finances, our communities, our school systems, our government. Even our churches have fallen prey to the doctrines of demons, have they not? Luke 2:14. If someone would read that, please. Pull it up and or turn to it and read it. 2:14. It's quoted in every Christmas program every year. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men. You need to understand that Jesus came to restore peace and goodwill between God and man. It's glory to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill, or peace and goodwill toward men, not among men. Understand that. Jesus came to restore peace and goodwill between God and man, not peace on earth just among men, because Jesus declared war on earth when he came with the devil. And this war would take place among men. Matthew 10:34-38. Would someone please read that? And remember tonight, this is all about knowing what you're enlisting for, knowing what you're signing up to do. Yes, Matthew 10:34-38. Help me, Lord, because this is not an easy text to speak about, is it? It's a harsh one. It's a harsh one. But notice in verse 34, he brought you a sword. He brought you a sword because you're in a battle, number one. He brought you a sword because you're in a battle, and he knew you would need a sharp one, because a double-edged sword that would divide your soul from your spirit, it would separate you from your flesh and your soul, your mind, will, and emotions from your spirit. And notice, you know, there was no need for weapons in the beginning. In the beginning, everything was perfect. There was no need for that, and there's no need for weapons in heaven. This war is right here, taking place in this lifetime. Verse 35 says, he came to set man at variance against his father, daughter against mother, mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law, etc. That is just harsh. That is hard to explain. How would you explain that to someone? How can you? How can you? I mean, and I've had people ask me this before. I tend to get stumped here. But when I was praying today and really studying this out, God, that sounds so harsh, but I'm going to tell you right now, the God I serve, it just doesn't sound like his characteristics, does it, Brother Keith? So it sounds like a contradiction, doesn't it? But God doesn't contradict himself, does he? What can this mean? The Greek word variance, or the Greek word for variance, is probably something that's a lot harder to say than variance. It's dishadzo. And it means to make apart. Not to make a part of, but to take apart, to separate, or to alienate. Now, if we put that in the context, that doesn't make it any... It doesn't make it a lot better, does it? So he wants to alienate or make me separate from not only myself, which that's not necessarily a bad thing, but from all the flesh that I'm attached to as well. My mother, my father, my sister, my brother. So not just from my own flesh, but from all the flesh that I'm connected to. Now you have to tell yourself here, the spirit, the things of the spirit are foolishness to the natural man. They don't make any sense, okay? So you need that first part. You need to be separated, your soul from your spirit, so you can communicate and understand what I'm about to tell you, okay? You need to be separated from your soul so you can understand. He came to set you at a variance, to call you out and to make you separate against the flesh that you're connected to. Why would God want to do that? God is a God that desired a family. That is why he created one. That is why he created us in the first place. Why would he want to set me against mine? Let me pray for me here that I can convey this to you. If I'm in a situation of sin, we're all born into sin, right? If I'm in a situation of sin and God removes me from that situation, I'm still connected to the people that I left behind by what? When Adam sinned in the garden, he was separated from God, but he was still connected to God because why? Because he loved him. He loved him. God loved Adam. I may have to leave my family sometimes, Brother Keith. I may have to leave somebody in a situation that I care deeply about. But that connection is still there, isn't it, Sister Linda? I love them. And you know what? They love me. Adam loved God too. He made a mistake. Eve made a mistake, but they loved him. That connection is still there. And even though they were separated from God, even though God may call me out of my situation and separate me from those that I love for a time, what is going to connect them to me is love. And eventually, they love me too. More than likely, 9 times out of 10, they're going to come find me. And if I'm walking toward Jesus, where are they going to be walking to? Not only are they going to find me, Sister Amanda, but they're going to find my Lord. They're going to find Jesus. That is why he will separate you. And you are not worthy of him unless you're willing to separate yourself, trusting him with those you leave behind. Because you can trust him with what you've left behind. He ain't forgot it. He ain't forgot it. He never will forget it because he loved them too. Hallelujah. I shouted and danced all over my office today. Tell me that. I shouted and danced all over my office today. Somebody needs to get excited because he has not forgot those you've left behind. And it even gets better. The word dischazo, probably say it different every time I say it tonight. So just understand. I already said that it means to make apart. It means to alienate and make separate. But it is a derivative of the Greek word dis, which means it comes from that word. And that word simply means twice. Again. I don't understand that. So, if Jesus came to set man at variance the second time, when was the first time? There had to be a first time, right? Because God's got an order. I mean, he didn't just, that wasn't a typo. Good old Father Abraham, right? Good old Father Abraham. We all know the story. We sung about it in children's church and grew up singing it. What'd he do? What'd God say? Get out. Leave your family. Leave your father's house. Get out. And I've never heard, I'm sure it's probably been taught, but maybe I just never made the connection. I always thought, what a sad ending. You know, Abraham never went back, did he? He never went back. But God is not a God of sad endings. Have you read the back of the book? We win, just in case you don't know. We win. God is not a God of sad endings, of bad endings. Abraham never went back. Jesus said, God called Abraham to get out of your country, get away from your father's house, go to a land that I'm going to show you. And we all know that Abraham left. He left, he forsook everything and followed the call of God on his life, and he never went back. But don't you know that before old Abraham died, what did he tell his oldest servant to do in Genesis chapter 24? He said, do not promise me. Put your hand under my thigh, because that was a sign of a promise back then. Promise me. Do not take a wife for my son Isaac from the daughters of these here Canaanites in the country that I'm dwelling. You go back to my family and my father's house in my country and get him a wife. So understand here, make this connection here. Isaac was the promise, right? Isaac was the promise united with his seed. But when he went back to his country, the promise didn't unite with the daughters of Canaanites. God didn't forget about what Abraham left behind. The promise united with Abraham's family, with his family. God connected it and tied it all back together. God used Abraham to bring back into right relationship what he had left behind. So when you say God, when God calls you out to leave your family and leave your, you got to leave some situations behind. Not all of them. Some of us have families and we all serve the Lord, praise God, and that's wonderful. But sometimes that's not so. Sometimes we have to walk away and leave. Sometimes we have to walk away and leave friends or people that we care about. But we have to trust that we're not just walking away, but we're leading. Somebody say leadership will cost you. It will cost you. Leadership is expensive. It's not cheap. When you walk away from something that is hard for you to walk away from, you have to trust that you're leading someone. So I ask you again, what is leadership in the kingdom? What's expected of me? Timothy says it's to fight the good fight. He also says it's to endure hardship like a good soldier. James tells us that it's all about submission. We have to submit to God in order to resist the devil, whom we are at war with. We have to die to our whole self, our pride, our opinions, our entitlements, our rights, everything. Jesus says, take up your cross. And you're doing this from the beginning. You take up your cross from the beginning. You take up that thing that will represent your death. So in the very beginning of your walk with God, when you sign up, you're laying down your life, right? We've all know this. We've preached about it. We've talked about it. We know this. It's about sacrifice. Romans 12:1 says, present your bodies a living sacrifice, because what? This is your reasonable service. This isn't your unreasonable service. Paul said he dies daily. Luke 14:28 says it's costly, and we need to count the cost before we take on this endeavor, that we will know that we will be able to finish. So all that being said, in a nutshell, it's a blessed life, but it's hard, isn't it? It's not easy, and we need to understand that. Matthew 7:14 says, narrow and hard is the path that leads to life, and there are few that find it. Am I one of the few? Are you one of the few? it will cost you. If you're ready, then welcome to leadership. And I don't know what all lies ahead of you when you accept this call. I don't know what will happen tomorrow. I don't know. I can promise you that you will have good days. I can promise you that you will have good days with blessing and you will experience amazing victory. But I can also promise you that you will have some bad ones. Brother Todd says, oh, that it rains on the just and the unjust. And we must endure during those bad ones like a good soldier. We will have days that every aspect of the battle will look like defeat all around. And you will have to. You will have to. See, we can pray for you, but there comes a time, and we should always do that. We should always hold one another up in prayer. But there comes a time where you must build yourself up on your most holy faith. You're going to have to do that. And on those days, that faith will have to see you through. We've been on spiritual mountaintops where we've had answered prayer that we knew it was answered prayer. We've witnessed miracles, but we've also lost people on the battlefield. I've had to bury people that I prayed for. Sometimes it appears as though we're losing in the natural. A battle, but you have to remember it's a battle. In the end, Sister Christy, we win the war. If you stay faithful, if you do not quit, what? You will reap the harvest. You will reap the harvest, Galatians 6 and 9. And I know this was kind of quick tonight, but I'm going to close here in a minute. But I have a quick story first. Let's see. I don't know if I'm going to use one of these or not. Let's see. This one's there. Okay. In the Navy SEALs, since we're talking about war tonight. The Navy SEALs is in a group, they're a group of elite soldiers that serve in our armed forces, right? The SEAL training is like basic training, except it's like times 100 on steroids. It's tough, okay? There are very few that have what it takes to endure this training to make it to become a U.S. Navy SEAL, very few. That's why they're called elite. That's why they're the Navy SEALs. That's why they're the best of the best. That's why they send them in when nobody else can get the job done, right? So at the beginning of this training, every soldier, every one of them is given a quit option. It's a bell. It's not this small, actually. From what I understand, I think it's a rather large one in the center of the camp for everybody to see. But every soldier is given a quit option at the beginning of their training, and it's a bell. It's located in the camp, very large, in plain sight. So you can walk by your quit option every single day. It's right there in your face. Your easy way out, your quit option. It's there to remind you that you have an alternative. If you don't have to endure this, Brother Chuck. You don't have to if you don't want to. If a soldier decides to quit, all he has to do is go and ring that bell, and that soldier is allowed to leave, and he's even allowed to go back to his place of service before he entered the SEAL training. So he really has lost nothing. I mean, it looks that way anyway. It appears that way. He didn't lose what he had before. Let me say it that way. He didn't lose anything that he had coming in. He's allowed to go back to his place of service. Somewhere towards the end of that SEAL training, they will endure what is known as Hell Week. And lots of the toughest don't make it through Hell Week. And when a veteran SEAL member was asked if he ever could tell who was going to make it and who wouldn't, his response was quick, and he said, "It's the ones who removed the quit option from the jump." If you haven't removed your quit option from the very beginning, you will walk by that quit option every single day. You will walk by that quit option when the enemy, on your toughest days, when you've had it, when you feel alone, when you feel like nobody understands, when you feel like nobody is praying for you, when you're sick, when you're tired, when it feels like everything looks like defeat. You will walk by that quit option if you haven't gotten rid of it from the beginning. Destroy that thing. Because even though it looks like you haven't lost anything behind you, you've lost everything in front of you. Everything in front of you. Some of you have been serving a long time. Some of you just started. And it doesn't matter how long you've been in service or how strong you started. If quitting remains an option to you, you will opt to quit eventually. Hell will see to it. They won't let up on you. They won't give you a pass. They won't say excuse me, and they will not give you a break. They will beat you down until you exercise your option to quit. You have to remove it in the beginning. You have to serve the Lord with a made-up mind. You have to, like Job did. Though he slay me, I will trust him. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, if he chooses not to deliver me, I still ain't going to serve your gods. They didn't make that decision when they were in the fire. They made that decision before they were probably ever taken into captivity. They knew it was not an option. They trusted the God that they served. It was never an option. I don't know what your option is tonight, but you do. You know what it sounds like. You know what it looks like. I don't know if it's a pill. I don't know if it's a drug. It may be the sound of an alcohol, you know, glass of vodka being poured over some ice. It may be a shopping. It may be a loan company. I don't know what it is, but whatever it is that makes you not want to do the hard thing is your quit option. Whatever it is, that thing that would make it easy for you to ring that bell. I came face to face with my quit option in a grocery store about 11 years ago. That slimy sucker, he slithered right up to me in the produce section. Funny thing about produce, that's tricky stuff. He did. And you know, he just was there to simply remind me. And it's always at a time when your back's against a wall. Your back's against a wall. I didn't know how I was going to pay my rent here. I had just received visitation back from my children, rights to see them, but I'd lost my job. And I'm in a place where I don't, you know, I'm still trying to prove myself fit to be their mother. If I can't keep the electricity on, I'm not going to be fit. If I can't pay the rent, I'm not going to be fit. I'm facing eviction. Every bill I got to do, I've lost my job. I got about 5 things in my cart, and I'm writing a hot check. I'm not joking. And my quit option comes slithering up through the apples, reminding me of my old life, reminding me, hey, you don't have to endure this. There's an easier way. You don't have to do this. You could always opt out. And don't you know I struggled with that? For the next 2 or 3 days, I walked right by that quit option. Every day it was in my face. Every day I walked by that quit option, it was in my face. Reminded me, I don't have to do this. I'm hungry, and I don't have, I'm not starving, but I don't have what I want in my refrigerator, and I can't buy my kids what they want. But I don't have to do this. A few days later into that, I had my all-in moment with the Lord. And I removed every single thing that ever reminded me of my old life. I threw it as far out of my house as I could get it. And I said, I trust you, Lord. I don't know what's ahead of me, but I know what's behind me. And I don't want any part of it anymore. Whatever you got for me, Lord, I want. Whatever it is, I trust you. I'm putting everything I got in you, Lord. Show me what you got. I trust you. I trust you. And don't you know, God is so good. He is so good. He is faithful. He supplies all of my needs according to his riches and glory, and still has to this day. That's been 12 years ago. And there's not been one single time that I have regretted throwing away my quit option. Not one time. Destroy that thing. Get it out of your sight. It's time. It's time. We are in a war, and you need to recognize it. And it's time that you wake up the mighty men. It's time. Where are the Davids of this world that will face a giant with a few rocks in their pocket and the word of the Lord in their heart? Where are they? Where are they? Where are the Joshuas? Where are the Joshuas who will take God at his word just because he said so? No matter what the voices of reason say. Where are the Elijahs who aren't afraid to face down Baal publicly? Where are they? Where are the Gideons who are going to come out smashing idols, Sister Amanda? Smashing them to pieces. Where are the salty men and women of God? Where are they at? Is it us? Is it us? Do you want it to be us? I want it to be us. Is it you? I'm not asking you to join a leadership club tonight. For the elite and the well-dressed and the well-powered. I'm asking you to count the cost and enlist, because we are in a season of war. We are in a season of war. And it's time that we have to recognize that. For those of you that have been coming to prayer meeting, you know I've been stuck in Joel chapter 2 since September. The Lord finally let me go to Joel chapter 3. And in closing, I'm going to read that to you, and then we're going to come up and have just a short prayer, or however long the Lord leads. But Joel chapter 3, verses 9 and 10 says, "Proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I'm strong." You may be a factory worker, or a secretary, or an overworked father, but tonight you've been called to be a warrior. You may be a business owner or a stay-at-home mom, but tonight you've been called to the front lines. You may be a basketball coach or a teacher or a retired person, but tonight you've been called to serve on active duty. He's raising up a generation. He's raising up an army that will hear his voice and answer the call. He's raising up pastors and teachers and prophets and evangelists and apostles. He's raising up laborers for his harvest field. And I'm going to ask you to come tonight, and we're just going to pray for one another. If it lasts 5 minutes, or if it lasts 10 minutes, or however it long, I just want us to come up here, pray for yourself and pray for one another. We can, those of you, the leaders want to come and pray for those that will come. We pray for one another to understand and to hear the call of God. And it, you know, if you're answering a call to leadership, you need to be asking yourself, what am I? Am I an apostle? Am I a prophet? Am I a teacher? Am I a pastor? Am I a leader? What am I? He's raising up Sunday school workers. He's raising up people to serve on active duty. And you need to be asking yourself, what am I? What am I tonight? And allow God to speak to you. Allow God to use you. So if you will, come tonight and just pray. We're going to pray with you. Ask God to lead you. Ask God to send workers into the harvest field. Ask God to use me. Remember the Lord's Prayer. We all prayed it before he came up tonight. You're asking God to use you to invade a kingdom that you are occupying. Yes, Father. Father in heaven, we just praise you and we thank you. I thank you, God. I thank you, God, for each and every person that's here tonight. I thank you, God, for Sister Valerie, Father. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that you begin to speak to her, Lord. I pray, God, that, Lord, as she comes to you, God, with an open heart and an open mind, Father, God, Lord, her ears be opened in the name of Jesus, and she hear your call, Father. God, that she hear you directly. God, that you
worship your holy.